Hello, I'm Alex Davies, founder of Wealth Club, and today I'm with Paul Atkinson of Par Equity to talk about investing in forestry assets. Why should experienced investors consider investing in forestry?
I think there's a few good reasons. One, the historic long-term returns in forestry have been extremely good. At one point, there was an independent index, IPED index, which showed 9.2% return over 25 years. More recently, I think it's been slightly better than that. It's also completely uncorrelated with other capital markets, and a pretty good hedge against inflation. And of course, at the moment, there's increasing interest in the asset class because of the climate change, carbon sequestration, and other factors.
It's also very tax efficient, isn't it? Can you tell me about that?
It is, yes. So there's no capital gains on timber, although there's on the underlying land, and there's no income tax on timber assets being sold. And there's no inheritance tax after holding the asset class for 2 years. So a lot of investors in forestry are looking at it as inheritance tax planning.
And who typically invests in forestry?
Typically, it's the high net worth investors, professionals at the top of their careers, partners in law firms and so on, and wealthy business families, and some smaller family offices. But we're also seeing increasing investment from financial institutions now and also companies, as you'll see with the recent acquisition by BrewDog of the site up in North Lowland.
And how do investors make a return?
Well, firstly, they make a return from the felling of forestry and sale into the market. Earlier in the forest lifetime, we also do some thinning, which produces some modest return. Obviously, the sale of capital assets, either at the end of the fund life or during the fund's lifetime, which will be largely free of capital gains tax. And then there's additional returns potentially from things like selling woodland carbon credits. There's potential development upside, hydro, peatland restoration, and so on.
And forestry's had a very strong number of years' performance. What's driving that return?
It's a combination of demand for timber for construction, and globally that's increasing. Of course, there was a bit of an abeyance during COVID and lockdown, but the resurgence has come back with the demand. Long-term demand for timber, everyone's seen that's going to continue. More and more timber being used for construction. You've got more and more uses for the forestry product itself and more institutional interest. And finally, carbon and carbon credits is now a key kind of factor in terms of driving returns, we believe.
And what do you mean by carbon credits? How does that work? How do you make money?
So when you buy a new planting site, you have the opportunity to register it for woodland carbon code credits. On day one, you're offered what are called provisional units, and there's an audit 5 years in, then 10 years in, and a further 10 years in. And over that time period, you're allocated carbon credits related to the amount of carbon being captured by the growth of the trees. And those carbon credits have a value. The current government guarantee scheme is in the range of 17 to 25 pounds per carbon unit. Most of the long-term forecasts are more upside than that. But it's obviously a relatively new market, so everyone's still getting used to how this is going to work.
And Brexit, has that been a bonus or a negative for forestry?
Well, there's a few implications of that, isn't it? So Brexit impacted currency. Currency is a key aspect of timber demand. So when the UK looks cheap in terms of pounds and sterling, foreign money comes in to buy our asset. But for us to buy things on the international market, it's more expensive because sterling's low. So that was one effect. I mean, the UK imports better than 2/3 of all the timber it uses every year. So we're a net consumer internationally. And although we export, we import huge amounts of timber.
And how risky is it?
The main risks around forestry are to do with tax risk. You know, will the government change the tax regime? There's no indication they will, but that's always a risk. There's political risk around land use and access to land for amenity as well, I think.
Especially if it's all in Scotland.
Yeah, potentially. Albeit that the Scottish government is actually very pro-investment in forestry and has very aggressive new planting targets, which they can't achieve. without supporting private investors coming into the market. So I wouldn't say it's any more politically risky than the rest of the UK in that respect. And then you've got climate change risks. So drought conditions are not good for forestry, potentially. Drought conditions stress trees, so disease risk becomes a more important factor. On the other hand, we get lots of rain in Scotland, for example, and the north. So it's not been that much of a risk so far, but you could see it over the next 30 years becoming a bigger risk.